Well, this morning I'm actually speaking about the privilege of being an ambassador for Christ. And when we think about that, it takes us back to ask the question, who or what am I? I'm saying that rhetorically for you. You know, we could all say, who or what, who am I? What am I? And there are lots of answers to that question. I'm going to ask some questions. Who here is a son? Yeah, I'm a son. No, you ladies, put your hands down. You can't possibly be a son. What about daughters? We've got some daughters here. Yeah. Have we got some wives here? Have we got some husbands here? Yeah, husbands, yeah. Got some parents here. Oh, yes, lots of us are parents. Got some single people here. Yeah, we've got some single people here. Yep, good on you, Caleb. You're one currently. That'll change in a few years' time, but, you know. As Christians, we can ask the question again. Who here is a child of God? A child of God. Who's a son of the Father? Yeah, we're sons of the Father, aren't we? Who is a daughter of the Father? Yeah. Well, we're getting the idea of putting our hands up. Here's one. Who here sees themselves as an ambassador? An ambassador. Yeah, that's really important, isn't it? Because Gavin read from Corinthians chapter 5, it says, therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ. Ambassadors for Christ. And that's what we're looking at this morning. I would long that every one of us would go away, those of us who know Jesus, we would go away today with it imprinted on our hearts and minds, this truth that I am an ambassador for Christ. An ambassador. I did think about making badges to hand out to everybody who wanted to declare themselves to be ambassadors for Christ. You know, I'm going to flick across that because we've already done that. Ambassadors. When we think of an ambassador, what do we think of? Well, anyone know who that is? Kim Beazley. Do you know, I've got a soft spot for Kim Beazley. I reckon he got a pretty raw deal. Now, some folk are not here this morning, so I can declare myself in this. I come from a conservative background. And of course, Kim Beazley was on the other side of politics. But you know, he seemed to be a really genuine bloke. And maybe that's why he never got to be Prime Minister of Australia. I don't know. He professed to be a believer. And he became the Australian ambassador to the United States of America. And he was that under successive governments. It didn't matter whether Labor was in power or the Conservatives were in power. He was our ambassador to the US. Here's another one. Now, there's controversy for you, isn't it? A man who some would say couldn't sort out the economy of Australia is now in this position of representing Australia to the American government. Well, he is an ambassador, and there are lots of ambassadors. And in the general run of things, ambassadors are often political appointees. They represent and speak for their home country, their home government, before the leaders or rulers of other countries. That's what ambassadors do. They speak only what their government gives them authority to say. They can't speak on their own authority. They're an ambassador representing somebody else. I'm guessing that you're seeing the application of this already, aren't you, to us as ambassadors for Christ. In the eyes of those rulers, leaders in other countries, the word of an ambassador is the word of the government that he or she represents. Now, that's objective fact, or it's supposed to be what happens. Do you know, the people of God are his ambassadors on the earth. And we are appointed by our God to this significant role in the world in which we live. You might remember Moses coming to Pharaoh. Boy, that's an old picture, isn't it? Moses was appointed by God, the great I Am, to go back to Pharaoh with a message from God. And we won't go into all the reluctance of this ambassador, but God dealt with all of that. But the day came when he stood before Pharaoh and he said, "The Lord God says, let my people go." Now, note that Moses didn't want to go. Moses was a reluctant ambassador. Moses was afraid. Moses came up with all sorts of excuses why he couldn't do that. Couldn't speak. What a con that was. Trained in the schools of Egypt. It was more to do with fear than anything else, I believe, that Moses was reluctant to be an ambassador for God. Moses spoke God's words to Pharaoh and also to the children of Israel. We are called to be ambassadors for Christ. We are to speak God's words to those around us, and we are to be God's voice to each other. That's a wonderful privilege, you know. It really is. As it says in verse 20, that now then, we are ambassadors for Christ. It is as though God is pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. You know, I've been very thankful that John Gollan can't save anyone. And I guess you're glad about that too. I always maintain that if someone became a follower of Jesus simply because I was a good talker and I talked them into it, they would only continue to be a follower of Jesus until a better talker came along. Salvation is of God. It is the Lord Jesus Christ who made salvation possible. It is the Holy Spirit working in people's lives that convicts people of their need of salvation. It is his work to take the things of Jesus and reveal them to the hearts of people and minds of people. It is the Holy Spirit's task to bring the wonderful miracle called spiritual new birth. And so when we think about salvation, we are able to say, salvation is of God. It's of God. And if you're a saved person here, and I believe the vast majority of people here this morning are, that's why you're here, we can all say, we thank God that salvation has come to our lives. It's not because we deserved it. It's not because we're particularly worthy. It's just we're ordinary people. We needed a Saviour, and Jesus put his hand up and he said, I will pay, so that we can be forgiven, so that we can be reconciled to God. Now, there's a chief ambassador, and just sort of ignore the graphic. It doesn't mean anything to me particularly. But this is the Lord Jesus. He said this in John 5:30, by myself I can do nothing. I judge only as I hear. My judgment is just. I seek not to please myself, but him who sent me. Now, there's a statement, isn't it, of what it is to be an ambassador. Don't speak on my own initiative. Only what I'm told, I repeat, I say. I'm not seeking to please myself. I'm seeking to please the one who sent me. And I think there's a real principle there for us as ambassadors for Jesus. The chief ambassador said, I didn't speak on my own accord. The Father who sent me commanded me what to say and how to say it. I know that his command leads to eternal life. So whatever I say is just what the Father told me to say. Isn't it good that we don't have to make up the gospel? We just have to share it. know it for ourselves, and then share it with others. You know, I've had contact with a young lady who isn't walking with God anymore. And the reason she says that is it's just too hard. It's just too hard. And I agree, in our own strength, being a follower of Jesus is just too hard. But with the strength and the grace and the wisdom that God provides, we indeed are more than able. We are more than conquerors. Just stop for a moment. Thank you for those who supported us at the beach mission this last week. We had a lovely time. It only rained once, and that was in the night time. Woke me up, the rain hitting the roof. And I got up and walked out, and it was heavy enough that nobody else was interested in wandering around at 3 a.m. in the morning. But it was a great week. People have said to me, would you rather wet or hot? And I said, give me hot any day. And many of you know how much I love the heat. Not, you know. But rain is very difficult to handle when you've got, 50 or 60 kids, and we're out in a paddock, out in the Brennan Park. But it was really great. And the greatest thing of all is the fact that I think it was Thursday, an invitation was given to boys and girls to invite the Lord Jesus into their lives. And there were 9 children who did. 9 children who did. And people have said to me, oh, they're only kids. And I say, no, life is a journey. And every one of us here this morning are on that continuum somewhere. We're on the journey somewhere. Is there anyone here this morning who is willing to get up and say that you've arrived? No, we haven't arrived. We're still on the journey. The arrival time will come when we stand in God's presence and He changes us finally and forever so that we perfectly reflect the character of God. We look through a glass dimly, the Apostle Paul said, but then face to face we shall be like Him, for we shall see Him as He is. Find that in chapter 13 of Corinthians. So we're very grateful, those of us who have been involved in the mission this week, for the week that has been passed. And already some are talking about next January. I can't think beyond the 31st of this January, but it's a wonderful outreach. And for ladies or folk who perhaps helped with morning tea or baked cookies or just whatever you did that involved them, the team, there was I think about 40 to 45 on the team. They had dinner here in air-conditioned comfort each night, Monday through Thursday. And there were folk who came and did that, and that was just a wonderful blessing. And I want publicly to praise God for the contribution of so many to make it so wonderful. As ambassadors for Christ, according to that passage in Corinthians, we receive a ministry of reconciliation. Verse 18, all things are of God who has reconciled us to Himself through Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. Now, what needs to be reconciled? Answer, man is set, human, I'm not talking about male man only, mankind, has been separated from a personal relationship with God because of sin. And there's a great divide. As the Bible says, your sins have caused a separation between you and God, such that God cannot hear even what we pray. So man and God is separated. But that is not God's heart. God's heart is that that separation will be destroyed, that gulf will be done away with, that He again can have an intimacy of relationship with His created mankind. And that's why Jesus came. That's why He came. And that's why He has given to us the ministry or the task, the to-do, if you like, of being God's mouthpiece that encourages others to come back into a relationship with God. I remember some years ago when we were in Tasmania, that's many years ago now, we had a Christian school there, and there were families who sent their children to the school. And do you know, sending children to a Christian school doesn't make them Christian any more than, I can't think of an illustration. Probably one of the saddest things in my life has been the fact that there were children in that school who spent 10 years in a Christian school and never came to a personal relationship with Jesus. That was a tragedy. And one, Jamie, when he finished school, he became a pieman, making pies in a bakery. But he followed in his father's footsteps, for his dad, before he became a Christian, was the town drunk. And Jamie followed that too, and he became just a hopeless alcoholic. And one day, his life ended while he was still young. And every now and again, I think about Jamie. I remember going to the local primary school, and the headmaster in the local primary school, he was really supportive of starting a Christian school. And he said to me, John, don't forget that with, he's referring to Jamie, you can't make a silk purse out of a sow's ear. You heard the saying? Yeah. And I remember Arthur Kerslake was his name, the principal. And I remember going home to Robin and saying, no, it's true. I can't make a silk purse out of a sow's ear. But God can. But God can. As an ambassadors for Jesus, we are not charged with the responsibility of saving people. We are only charged with the responsibility of representing God and His position, God and His truth in the world in which we live. And how delightful that Gavin brought along the shoes out of he Judy's wardrobe. Gavin's wardrobe. Okay. That's why they were looking so worn on the bottom, I guess. But our feet are shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. We have the sword of faith. We have the breastplate of righteousness. You know, the belt. All the armor of God. All the resources that we need are available. They were available for Moses thousands of years earlier, and they're available to us today, so that we indeed may be able to be faithful as ambassadors for Jesus. We have been given this ministry of reconciliation, and every now and again, and it should be more often than not, but every now and again I feel very much that I fail in that area. I call it the tragedy of missed opportunity. You know, God gives us lots of opportunities, but so often we don't look for them. We're not expecting them. They come along and suddenly they're gone, and I know I'll turn to Robin and I'll say, honey, gee, God gave us a great opportunity to share Jesus with that person and we missed it. And then I say, sin in haste, repent at leisure. We say, we'll pray for that person, that God will bring them into touch with someone else who will genuinely share faith with them. We receive a ministry of reconciliation. It is a powerful ministry, but it's one that we do not have to do in our own strength. It's a ministry to be fulfilled in the grace and power and strength which God provides. As ambassadors for Christ, not only do we have a ministry of reconciliation, but we seek to be peacemakers. The Apostle Paul said in 2 Corinthians 6:3, we give no offence in anything, that our ministry may not be blamed. You know, he said on another occasion, he said, we become all things to all men that by any means we may win some, we may bring people into a faith relationship. You would recognise this face. I think he's recognised the world over as a great Indian leader. I read his story through and I was challenged afresh by what happened in Mahatma Gandhi's life. He was born in India. He went to England and studied law, went back to India, then he went to South Africa. And while he was in South Africa, so one record says, he had contact with Christians. And Mahatma Gandhi made this very famous statement that makes my heart sad anyway. He said, "I like your Christ. I do not like your Christians. They are so unlike your Christ." Wow, that's a challenging statement, wasn't it? How different his world could have been if he had actually come to know and love and trust the Lord Jesus for himself. And I know his statement there is not a statement that we should become guilty or feel guilty about, but it does come as a challenge to us that we might so live our lives as ambassadors for Jesus that when people look at us, hear us, see us, in not only in word but in deed, in attitude, may they see Jesus. Do you know, I'm an ambassador for Christ. You are an ambassador for Christ. May people see the God whom we love, the Saviour whom we serve in our lives. Mahatma Gandhi. He was assassinated in 1948. You've seen pictures like this, as I have seen pictures like this. The anger in the hearts and lives of so many of the Islamic faith. The world is sort of dominated currently, aren't we, by the violence of ISIS or Daesh or whatever they're called. And the hatred that you see in people's faces. You know, an interesting thing about that is many of the Islamic faith, particularly stirred up by their religious leaders, it actually goes right back to a period of time called the Crusades. In the Crusades, so the papacy raised armies to go over and liberate the Holy Land from the infidel, and horrible things. It's a dreadful time in history, from about 800 AD to 1200 AD, in that period of time. A tragic time in history. That encourages me when I see tragic times in history today. There's nothing new under the sun, is there? We've seen it all before, haven't we? You know. This thing today is being motivated by a hatred of all things Christian because of the Crusades. They call Christians crusaders today as a justification for hating us. And an ambassador for Jesus is to be an ambassador for peace. And I say that knowing that there'll be some people who don't agree with me. But as an ambassador for Christ, there's a cost to pay. There's a price to pay for belonging to Jesus. And Paul said that in the 6th chapter of 2 Corinthians. That's the next chapter along after chapter 5. In all things we commend ourselves as ministers of God. Now just think about it. In much patience, in tribulation, in needs, in distresses, in stripes, in imprisonments, in tumults, in labours, in sleeplessness, in fastings. You know, Paul was really saying there was a price to pay for being an ambassador for Christ. What's the price that we're called to pay for being an ambassador for Jesus in 2017? Is there a price? Well, whatever the price might be, brothers and sisters, let's be willing to pay it. Let's be willing to say, yes, we, whatever it costs, whatever it takes, we will seek to be an ambassador for Christ. I don't know if any of you ever heard of Douglas Arnold Hyde. He was like a bit like a C.S. Lewis, and he wrote a book in 1952 called I Believe, and this is a quote from that. He said, "Such sacrifices, whether at the level of leaders or of rank and file, are impressive. People of every continent have responded to this example of idealism, expressing itself in terms of sacrifice. Indeed, the more materialistic our society becomes, the more the dedicated man stands out by way of contrast. The dedicated man makes his own appeal by virtue of the fact that he is dedicated." Now, we probably should read that again and think about it for a while. Because you can see, or I can see there, a very real parallel to being an ambassador for Christ. Being dedicated, being committed to be a representative, someone representing Christ in the world. But you know what? Douglas Arnold Hyde was a committed communist. He was very involved in the founding of the Communist Party in Great Britain. Earlier in that century. It was only later that he became a follower of God. And his statement here, talking about being dedicated, he was actually talking about being dedicated as a communist, not dedicated as a follower of Jesus. Later he became a follower of Jesus. What is the cost? What is the sacrifice? What do we surrender? What do we give up to be an ambassador for Christ? Well, ourselves, yes, that's very true. Yeah. The greatest thing that we can give God is ourselves, isn't it? Body, soul and spirit, just totally committed to Him. I thought about this quote from Douglas Hyde, and I thought, he could have been saying this last week. It would have been as equally true, wouldn't it? If it was just last week. But he was making this statement many, many decades ago. As ambassadors for Christ, we are to demonstrate positive qualities that commend the one we represent. Again, 2 Corinthians 6. By purity, by knowledge, by long-suffering or patience, by kindness, by the Holy Spirit, by sincere love, by the word of truth, by the power of God, by the armor of righteousness on the right hand and on the left, by honor and dishonor, by evil report and good report, as deceivers and yet true. Be positive about being an ambassador for Jesus. Don't be half-hearted. Be totally given over, like Lois says here. We give Him ourselves. I was going to say lock, stock and barrel, but I'm not quite sure of the origin of that. So sounds like there's a gun involved there somewhere or other. But it's a statement that we have. It's a saying that we have that points out the fact that there is no substitute for total commitment to the cause of Jesus Christ. We are ambassadors for Christ. Now, many of you would have heard of G. Campbell Morgan. He lived from 1863 to 1945. He was a great biblical scholar and author, and many people still read his works today. He has a daily devotional out. You can Google his name on the internet and you'll find heaps of stuff by G. Campbell Morgan. In fact, for the really old folk who went to Melbourne Bible Institute many years ago, G. Campbell Morgan would have got a mention, I'm sure, many times. When he was talking about the business of the kingdom as an ambassador for Christ, this is what he said, and with this I close. He said, "Make the must of his life the must of our life. In other words, the key of success as an ambassador for Christ is to so know Jesus that his attitudes become our attitudes. His values become our values. The things that he considered was important are the things that we consider to be important. Do we see that we are ambassadors for Christ? We do not speak on our own initiative. What God says, we say. What God does, we seek to do. The attitudes and the heart of God are the attitudes and the heart that we seek to influence in the world around us. Ambassadors for Christ? You betcha. Yes, we are called to be ambassadors. We are ambassadors regardless. You know, it's a bit like we could say if we've ever professed faith in Jesus, we're all Christians. But are we having a good witness, or is our witness not good? We are ambassadors for Christ. Let us go forth into this world and be faithful and true as ambassadors for Jesus. Let's pray, shall we? Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for the privilege of being an ambassador for Christ. We thank you, Lord, that you are with us to empower us and to help us. We thank you, Father, that you sent Jesus and that he reconciled us to you and has entrusted to those of us who've come to know you the ministry of reconciliation. That you can take our lives and you can take our words and our attitudes and our actions and speak into the hearts and lives of others with this same message. We beg of you on Christ's behalf to be reconciled to God. And dear Father, if there's anyone here this morning who is not in that place of being reconciled to you, we pray your Holy Spirit will speak into their lives today and will wonderfully draw them to yourself, that they too may come to know the absolute wonder of being forgiven and of being restored into that relationship with yourself that is so vitally important. Oh God, grant us to be faithful witnesses for Jesus as we seek to be ambassadors for Christ this week and this month and for the rest of our lives. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.